Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Hima ma'am.
Good
Welcome.
afternoon, everyone.
Yeah, the speaker is also there. We
Yes,
all
I can
chemistry
see.
teachers are there. Yeah.
Fantastic. I can see Shaurya Chaturvedi. Good afternoon, Shaurya.
Good afternoon. How are you, ma'am?
I'm fine. How are you?
Very well.
So good to see you.
So
Good
good to
to
see
hear
you as
from you.
well.
So can we start, Dr. Valicha?
Yeah, shall we?
Yeah, how
Your
many
permission,
participants?
ma'am.
You are still expecting participants, I can see.
Yeah, we can begin. I think they'll slowly join in. We are admitting them first.
All right. All
Shall
right.
we start?
Yes, absolutely.
Oh, then we'll start, huh, ma'am?
Yes.
Good afternoon, all. KC College Chemistry Department has organized a talk on how to create products that matter. The topic is relevant of today's time and will help us gain more knowledge and insight about the scenario. The coronavirus outbreak has its own impact on all aspects of society and businesses across the globe. And stakeholders are trying to figure out how best to respond. Initial impact is on the marketing and sales. To help us understand the strategies, we have our esteemed speaker, Mr. Shaurya Chaturvedi. We are extremely delighted that you have joined us for the webinar, Shaurya Chaturvedi. And on behalf of HNC University, KC College, I extend a warm welcome to all the students, fellow colleagues, senior teachers, Vice Principal Justin and Shalini ma'am. And I also welcome our own dear principal, Dr. Hemlata Bagla. Our principal, Dr. Hemlata Bagla, needs no introduction. Madam is an able, dynamic administrator who leads always from the front. I request Principal Ma'am to welcome the speaker and address the participants over. Address the participants. Over to Principal Ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Good afternoon,
Hello.
everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Good
Yes,
afternoon,
yes.
everyone present here. All the participants across Mumbai, across India, or from different colleges of Mumbai, and especially KC College, all the teachers, heads of the department, vice principals of KC College, and principals and vice principals of other colleges, a warm welcome to you to this webinar. Yes, during the COVID-19 pandemic, we always say that webinars have become epidemic, but educationists are taking it in a different direction. They are wanting to engage students' life and students' time into a brighter direction. So I congratulate Department of Chemistry, each and every one who has put up this program, and also warm welcome to our young dynamic speaker, our Shaurya Chaturvedi. And let me tell you, Shaurya, it was wonderful speaking to you today morning. Maybe I felt I woke you up, but the thought was of my curiosity about the problems whether we are searching or they exist or we are creating, we do not know. But it's all about the solutions we look out for. So there's a saying that whether the problems came first or solutions came first, but if you look at in terms of software engineering, they always feel that problems, solution existed much before the problem. But leaving that all aside, I feel that we must recognize hammers in search of nails, as they say. So if you have a hammer in your hand, every problem appears to be a nail. But whether you want to choose one hammer as a tool, or you have to choose many tools to fix the nails, I think that is in all hands of you creators, that you create a product which can cater to whether schools or colleges or society or businesses. So I think you are here to give many answers, that how do you come out with new products and with a good thought process, which I think a takeaway from you, that in this 45 minutes, you are not going to dive deep into the subject, but you will surf through the ocean and tell us What is it? What should be our attitude? How stepwise we identify our problems and solutions and understand the products and you should utilize them also to cater to the society. I do not know much about this subject because I haven't heard you before, but this is what is my thought process. And I thought that, yes, let us pick up the drops of your knowledge today and learn something from you. So, and we are very happy when youngsters like you train the trainers. So once again, a warm welcome to Shaurya Chaturvedi. And let me tell you, your melodious voice and your knowledge really made me think that 45 minutes wouldn't be sufficient. So over to the organizers, over to Dr. Valecha. Once again, I welcome each one of you who has organized the program, who are participating in the program. And also, if you're recording it, so that you can send it out to those people, those students who are not part of this program, so that we should make the most out of every minute in this COVID times. So thank you so much for asking me to be starting this program. You all do hard work and make me start the programs always. So over to each one of you. And one last thing, I thank Dr. Chau Chaturvedi, because I don't know from where, which oceans she picks up these gems and puts in front of us. And I have to learn this magic from her. So I think you have that magic. So thanks to you. So over to all of you to take it forward. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes, Charu, you can start with the instruction.
Okay. Charu, ma'am, introduce the speaker today.
Okay, sir. Good afternoon, everyone. Hope you all are doing well during this period of lockdown. In the spirit of Make in India and creating an Atmanirbhar Bharat, today's webinar will focus on creating products that matter. And who can be better to talk about it than someone who is entrepreneur at heart and has been helping business develop throughout his career, Mr. Shaurya Chaturvedi. He is currently working with Noon.com, which is Amazon or Flipkart equivalent of Middle East region. He assists the senior management of Noon in mentoring new hires and has championed the creation and development of three products at Noon: their payments gateway, their loyalty program, and their digital wallet, all of which focus on leveraging technology and innovation to achieve revenue generation in this new and highly disruptive ecosystem. Without much ado, I would like to invite Mr. Shaurya Chaturvedi for today's webinar. Over to you, Shaurya.
Thank you so much, Dr. Charu, for that unimaginable introduction. And thank you, Dr. Hemlata, for your call in the morning and inviting me to this platform. Good afternoon, everyone. To all the doctors, to all the professors, the vice principal and principal and vice principals of the other university present today. Welcome all students. Thank you each and everyone for taking out your precious time today for this webinar. I would like to start with reflecting on the current COVID situation with a couple of positive words for all the students who have taken out their time for this webinar. Where you are right now is not where you will be in the future. The only way to change your current circumstances to begin by believing that you can be more than you currently are. See, the thing is, as individuals, we actually have unlimited powers. And only our mind stops us from getting where we want to go. Each and every one of you, you already know what you need to do. You just need to break through the fears that are blocking the path in front of you. A secret over here, that is, if you really want to be successful as the top 5%, then you need to stop acting like the remaining 95%. The world you desire can be won. It exists. It is real. It is possible. It is yours. And honestly, life is taught to play small with your inborn talents. the problem that we actually fail to identify is most of us fail to keep the ball rolling. And that's the very reason why we don't achieve the desired results. When you have a big dream, people are going to laugh at you. And that's just part of the process. It's also okay to have self-doubt, but commitment and following through will lead you to success. I don't know a lot about cricket, but I'll try using an example over here. The truth about achieving your goals isn't a case of hitting sixes like Yuvraj Singh. It is a case of consistently taking singles like Virat Kohli, the way he supports his teams in IPL matches when every ball and every run counts. If you want to make a dent in your goals, you need to start by working on them on a regular basis. Let's look at today's overview of how to create products that matter. So I'll be covering two key topics today, and those are the product life cycle and its seven phases. I just want to check if everyone is able to see the slide.
Yes, sir. No issues.
Fantastic. Thank you. So product management is both exciting and difficult. As you are solving real-world problems and trying to create a value for the customer. In my personal opinion, this is a paradox, as it is a constant balancing act of trying to move forward and living up to the expectations of many, many departments and many, many customers. Product management is a unique position. They are the central point of communication as they define the entire product. The conversation actually changes from one relationship to the next. Let me give you an example. If you can see the picture on the right, finance won't care about product positioning. Instead, they would want to know more about return on investment. This breadth of reach across the company is the reason product managers are known to reach the C-level of any organization as their careers progress. No other job in any company will give you this breadth of responsibility. One of the key things that as a product manager, you're never supposed to forget is that your role in any organization is to represent the customer. Depending on the day or the hour, you'll be standing for the customer as you discuss their problem, a possible solution, and the best way to market to them. This customer-focused process will help you repeat the cycle over and over again as you zero in on the right solution for your customers. Okay, so all the participants over here, if you have to guess what percentage of products fail, you can maybe answer in the comment box if that's okay. If you just had to guess a percentage. Shubham said 90%. Wow. Okay. These are actually right answers by all of you. Well, as I said,
the correct answer is 60-90% of the ideas
actually fail, and that's a huge number, and that is a lot of time, effort, money down the drain. With regards to that, allow me to take you through a comic strip which will justify this answer. So this is how the customer explained it.
This is how the project leader understood it. This is how the
analyst designed it.
This is how the programmer wrote it. This is how the business consultant described it. They always, like to
do the fancy things. This is how
the project was documented. This is how the operations installed it.
And this is how the customer was built. How it was actually supported. What the customer really needed was this. Understanding from this comic strip, there are many reasons to these failures. Poorly defined ideas, the lack of quality customer input, little to no market research, or poorly defined or miscommunicated value propositions. I think this comic strip did a great job of highlighting and illustrating the risk of a poorly defined product. So one of your job is to look deep into what the customer says and listen to what they really, really need. Let's continue. Let's look at the product lifecycle map. So this phase is divided into 7 phases, which is the complete arc of product lifecycle. You start by imagining a new product in the conceive phase. You then plan on how to create the product. Your development team works on developing the product. And during the qualify phase, your customer tests it to see if it meets their needs. You eventually launch the product in the market and keep the sales coming by maximizing sales through marketing efforts. And if at all the time comes, you carefully and gracefully retire the product. At a higher level, the process is divided into strategy with the conceive and the plan phase, and then followed by the 5 execution phases. Now let's look at the phase gate process, which is the most important within the map. So phases is where the work is being done, and gates are where the decisions are being made. During each phase, there are pre-described activities that each department needs to complete before the decision gate. The goal is to arrive at the gate with all elements of the exit criteria completed. Having gates can reduce the risk of continuing to invest time, efforts, money in a project that is maybe off track. At each gate, the key decision makers, which is the senior management team, can decide whether to move the product forward, kill it, or maybe go back to your drawing boards. Before we go any further, let's make sure that we all are speaking the same language when it comes to product management. What is a product? A product could be a method, information, object, service, which serves a need or satisfies a want. It has a combination of tangible and intangible attributes that seller offers a buyer for purchase. Before we deep dive into the 7 phases, we'll start by looking at strategy, which is the most important in the entire product management phase. To achieve success, you should always focus on the core story, or as they say, why. Why your business or product exists. Then you can explain how and what you are doing to solve the why. My suggestion is, if ever you are proposing a strategy to your stakeholders, start with why. And this is exactly why you will get the maximum buy-ins. When developing your product strategy, my suggestion is you align all the areas of the business, because strategic alignment happens when all parts of this pyramid line up in a way that reinforces the company's strength. At the top, you'll have the company vision and mission statements. Some visions can apply to many companies, but it's the way the vision the mission is accomplished that differentiates each company. The objectives measure progress towards strategic objectives. The culture and value must line up with overall vision and mission of the company. If there is a mismatch, the entire pyramid is unstable and customer loyalty will suffer, as business results would probably be down the track. And as you formulate your strategy, you will have to consider the life cycle of the product. So let's look at the four stages of product life cycle. Here at the top of the chart, we can see some common trends of sales and profit shown at each stage of the product life cycle. Below, we see how market objectives, competitions, and marketing efforts change at each of these stages mentioned above. Knowing where you are in the product life cycle is important to determine marketing, product actions, and what to avoid. There are four parts, starting with the introduction of the product to the market. If it succeeds, it enters the growth phase. Once the product has completed the growth phase, it enters the mature phase. And finally, the demand of a product declines and product sales decreases. In some cases, you may be able to extend the life of the product with add-ons. That is called a product line extension. The top line in the graph shown here is the total revenue, and the line underneath is its profits. The largest profits occur during the mature phase, as you can see here. Selling to an existing market is one thing, since the demand is pretty clear, and this is like a dream come true. But not all products make it to maturity. By combining the adoption and the chasm model, we can learn a lot about what different customers are looking for at different times as we introduce new products. Let's start by looking at the bell curve here. Imagine we have a brand new idea. Initially, the underlying benefits of the product are not widely appreciated or accepted. Instead, innovators and early adopters latch onto the product and try them out. These customers are less interested in the product. Instead, they are actually interested in the new ideas and technology. When the product offering starts to become tangible benefits of how currently we do things, then pragmatists become interested. And at this point, the sales and profit rise dramatically. When offering becomes easy to adopt and use, then even the conservatives become interested. And finally, there are the laggards that only adopt new ideas when they are old, and simply they cannot find an alternative to their current use of a product or a service. It is important to know that a product can actually die at any stage. In the tech industry, there are times when the chasm opens up. This is basically maybe like a cool new way of doing something. So let's start by looking at the conceive phase. So conceive is the first of seven phases of the product map. Conceive takes the first idea from thought to development. This is a low investment process to identify and conduct an initial evaluation on potential market opportunities to determine if greater resources, efforts, time, money should be committed. The goal here is to learn quickly and test as many problems and solutions. And the team here is really small. It can just be you or your immediate participating friends, as you call them, partners in the long run. As you develop
ideas for new products, you will need to consider whether it is an idea worth pursuing.
Not just for the sake of creating new things. In other words, is there a good product market fit?
And first of all, is there a problem worth solving? Enough people have to be willing to pay for it. Your company eventually has to develop that product. That product should be able to solve the market problem.
And finally, you need a business model that will make the company money. Think of it as spinning three plates, one on each hand and one on your foot. It's hard to keep everything spinning and balanced at the same time. As you work through the conceive process, it can help to foresee issues that you might run into with regards to product market fit, as we looked at in the slide above. So here you can see four product market fit on certainty quadrant. For both the product and the problem, you can either be in the defined or the undefined stage, as you can see on the right over here on the screen. Type one ideas are well-defined product and solutions that you are most likely to optimize and improve on an idea. If you have a well-defined problem,
but the product is new, then you will be in type two, which is market-driven, wherein product management is really, really important.
It is an opportunity to basically discover customer problems that aren't being solved today. If customers don't even realize that they have a need, this is type three. And this is tech driven. You have a technology and you're looking for a problem to solve. Type four is visionary, wherein both the product and the problem are undefined. But there are many still unique opportunities out here in type four that can be potentially discovered. After you're satisfied that you have a good understanding of the problem you are trying to solve, you can, as you can see here, you can probably look for a possible solution. We'll begin with the problem phase shown here on the right. Here we will focus on the customer experience. We see here that the problem phase has three steps. We investigate the opportunity, screen this to see if it is a good market fit, and if it fits with our business need as well.
And reconfirm if the market has a problem with solving. The solution
space involves brainstorming ideas,
which you can see on the left over here, developing concepts, and then validating them with customers. This process is intended to give you continuous guidance in what to do next. Let's look at the second phase over here, which is the plan phase. This is where you develop
plans that the rest of the company is going to execute.
When it comes to planning, one of the first things that we have to do is market research. This is where we validate our concept or idea. This is a process of organized efforts to gather information about markets and customers. The benefits of market research are enormous. If managed properly, they can dramatically reduce the risk of any project because everyone is always asking for proof.
market research can build a case for fact-based decisions that are very difficult to accomplish otherwise. Before I continue, I just want to check if you all can see the slides and if my voice is clear.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Everything is very clear and very
fantastic. Fantastic. So let's look at some of the ways market research, several ways in which we can do market research. Understanding these methods and knowing how to analyze data will set you up to make better decisions, whether it's your personal life or your professional life. Primary research is the research that your company undertakes as they answer specific questions. And on the other hand, secondary research is information that is publicly available, like Google. With quantitative research, you talk to the customer and get a better understanding of their pain points. This is my favorite. This information is great, but it will not give you the hard numbers that you may need to convince your boss or your company or your investors to, you know, invest money in a new idea or a product that you're trying to develop. This is where quantitative research comes in, wherein you collect numbers. So this is basically where you'll have answers like X percentage of people have this kind of problem. A common mistake is putting too much faith in a customer's stated intention, as this does not always match their observed behavior. Allow me to share an example with you over here. So when Sony was trying to launch their Walkman back in the day, they invited some of the customers and they told them to, they questioned them, what is your favorite color? So everyone had different answers from green, red, yellow, blue, etc. They noted these answers down. And when these customers were leaving the company, they were walking out of the building towards the end. There's another team that came in and told them to pick a Walkman for free. All of these customers that said their respective color is red, green, yellow, but they all picked one color, which was black. So my suggestion is never go by their stated behavior, but always go by their observed behavior. So always investigate the difference between what someone says and what someone actually does before you make the bets on a new idea. Market research isn't just about talking to customers. It is important to look at current and historical data from a wide variety of sources, both internally and externally. So there are many ways to know what your competition and the type of the competitive analysis that you do. There are many ways to do this and many ways to look at it. And this is a constant process that happens throughout the product lifecycle. Comparative analysis is a deliberate study of strategic and tactical strengths and weakness of current and potential competition. Let me share my secrets with you over here. You should always be assessing your competition on a regular basis. Put yourself in the shoe of your customer and figure out how they really view your competition. If you are able to identify the top 2 to 3 competitors and beat them by your planning or your idea, then you probably don't have to worry about the rest of the competition that follows. During the planning stage, as we are currently seeing over here, you should look at your competition in the future state. Not today, but when your product will be available in the market to your customers. What will the market look like then? What other products will be available? What new regulations might be in place by the government? All of these questions should be your target. And the most important point, number 5, that you're not supposed to forget is never lose sight of your competition.
this brings us to our third phase. If you think about the process that we've been following, first you plan and then you develop. But in reality, you are always planning. And a lot that we learn here in develop will make you become a better planner. So now, beginning with develop, we are now focused on execution. At the end of the plan phase, there will be a long list of deliverables that each department will create. Let's look at two different development models. These operate specifically during the plan phase and the develop phase and the qualify phase that we will see next. So these are called waterfall and agile. There are many complexities to both, but we'll keep it very basic for now. Waterfall is a traditional development process typically used for hardware or larger products like a microwave, a fridge, or a laptop for that matter of fact. Agile is used more often when developing softwares like Zoom that we are currently using. In Waterfall, the product is completely defined and heavily documented before development begins. And in Agile, there is less detailed planning upfront. Instead, the outlines of the product and the ultimate vision are defined. And the teams keep developing one piece at a time because this allows them to get constant customer feedback and then work on the development, keep correcting the development one at a time. Now this brings us to the qualify phase. Before you launch anything in the market, it is a good thing to check with your customer if your product meets their needs. You can think of this as the final validation before launch. And we refer to this as the qualify phase. In a traditional waterfall development process, products are developed in stages. The first sort of working version for internal company use is called alpha. Here, major issues and bugs are identified and fixed. And now, post this, you will end up with a more stable product called beta. The beta still might have few bugs, but it is good enough to show to a wider audience, maybe your immediate friends and family. Based on feedback from testing your beta, you can produce a gold master. This version, this final version, will go into production. So during the qualify phase, the product that we share with the customers is called beta. At the end of the qualify phase, you have reached another gate. If you remember the slide that we looked above of phase and gate. So gather up all the data collected during your beta program and question yourself. Are you ready to ship the product? Are there features missing? What about bug fixes? Does the product solve the customer's problem as promised? Does your marketing messaging resonate with the right people? Will it work? Will the marketing work? Does the product qualify to launch? If the answer is no, then plan on having some serious discussions with your company. Everyone else in the company is ready to go and you say stop. This is no way to win a popularity contest. But if it is the right thing to do, then you should do it. This brings us to our launch phase. Just imagine the time has finally come. You have developed and qualified your product, and now you're ready to announce it to the world. Let's look at what it takes to launch a product successfully. you will know that your product is ready to launch when you have all three of the launch puzzle firmly in place. First, your product is ready and it's finally validated through your qualify phase. Second, your company is ready to deliver the product. And third, marketing has everything ready for launch and your salespeople, including your external sales partners, are ready to talk about the products with the customers on day one. Not all products have the same market impact. Not all products are launched the same way. And not all products need to be launched in the first place. Let's look at some common type of launches. There are three type of launches: the soft launch, minimal launch, and the full scale launch. Depending on your product, budget, resources, you'll fall in one of these, any one of these buckets. There are certain conditions when you might want to consider a soft launch. This is like a soft opening of a retail store. It is a preview release of a product or a service to a limited audience prior to it being available to the general public. The next step is in the effort and effectiveness is a minimal launch. This type of launch is like version 2.1 of a product or a version that addresses only one type of market or customers. If you are considering a minimal launch, the most important thing to do is focus. Target your money effectively and use guerrilla marketing tactics instead of investing money to get your point across. Let the industry experts or influencers tell your story. Initially, and hopefully, you will find yourself in a position to do a full-scale launch where you'll have all the marketing budgets. With a full-scale launch, you are addressing the entire world, or at least your entire market. And yes, they do cost a lot. Everyone in your company, whether it's marketing, sales, gets involved to make this a success. And believe me, if it's done right, your product will fly off the shelf. Moving on, maximize is the last step of execution before we plan for end of life and retire the product. During the maximize phase, you will implement the marketing strategies that you had planned during the plan and the launch phase, as we have seen before. In the maximize phase, the only goal is revenue. If you want to maximize revenue, you need to know your buyers. You need to know what motivates them, what turns them on and off, where they shop, how they'll even know that your product exists. There's a process in which people buy, and your marketing will have to align to this process for their efforts to be most effective. The question is, how do you know when you are delivering great marketing? So underlying each marketing program are four key components, as you can see on the left over here. Your positioning is correctly targeted to specific segments. The way that positioning is delivered makes sense to the customers, whether it's delivered digitally, physically, or both. Your language also suits the target customer. If your target customer is, say, for example, a high school audience, your language should reflect that. Your language then moves your customer to the next stage, meaning, what is their call to action? Your messages
should always be delivered at the right time. There's a common process that buyers go through when they first discover your product and then eventually buy your product, as you can see on the right over here. Understanding this process, understanding this funnel that you can see on the right over here, can help you maximize your marketing efforts. First, they become aware about your offering. Then they express interest. Then they evaluate with the product that they are already consuming or buying. And then eventually they commit to purchasing. Truly loyal customers are driven to refer your product to others or can be encouraged to do so with loyalty points and loyalty programs. I have a question for you. Please feel free to write in the chat box. Can anyone tell me why is this buying process on the right? Why is it in a shape of a funnel? Anyone, let your assumptions go wild. Think about it. Ecosystem starts off with a wide audience, so eventually your customer, fantastic. Steps two, increase the reach of your company, fantastic. On the basis of importance, very nice. Marketing process, absolutely. Let me answer that for you. Because at each stage, potential customers drop off. Many people may be aware about your product, but less are interested. And even fewer will evaluate, and a smaller number will commit. Noting your numbers at each and every stage, collecting that data will basically help you, make better investments of your marketing dollars that are given to you by your company. Okay, so we've reached the end of life and the retire phase. We see here that retire is the last phase of execution. During this phase, it is important that we communicate what's happening both internally within our company and externally with our customers. In this phase, communication is key. Just like with any other phase, retiring a product also requires planning. And finally, when the product is dead, the company and the teams have to do a full postmortem, as they say. And, a lot of the bigger organizations actually have an entire department dedicated to the retire phase, or as they call it, end of life. So after all the work it took to conceive, plan, develop, qualify, launch, maximize your product or your service, you may feel like it should last forever. But as we know from the product life cycle, all good things must come to an end. At some point, your product isn't selling as much as it used to. It's either ready to be replaced, or the market that you are doing your business in, that market itself is dying. This may be a good time to retire the product. And this is also called end of life. Just like during development, retiring a product requires product management. The choices during the retire phase can impact many things, including your brand and your customer loyalty. Retiring a product means that a product or a service is no longer being sold or no longer serves the purpose. The benefits are dead. This should be approached strategically, and end of life should not be taken lightly. nor should the process be done carelessly. You have to spend a lot of time. In the past, you have spent a lot of time telling your customers that your product can solve their problem or satisfy their need. And now you're taking it away from them. Why? Maybe you're simply replacing it with something newer, a new technology that can do a better job. Or maybe simply there is too much competition in the market. Two of the most important goals during this process is to perceive or hold the customer's loyalty and profits and avoid any negative PR or any negative outcomes, because this can actually seriously damage your brand. It's really rare that during this end of life scenario, the customer is happy. The best you can hope for is that they won't be too unhappy. That's why it's always better to have customers that will be loyal to your company or your brand as opposed to the product that you're offering. And it's not just your customers who will complain. Your own management or sales might be holding on to the past. After all, they learned how to sell it, and sales might still be getting commission on those few customers who are buying the product. You might have a large amount of inventory in a warehouse somewhere. The process can be costly. The benefits of pushing through retiring a product aren't immediately obvious. But when you no longer support old versions of a product, your company has more resources in terms of bandwidth, employee efforts, employee strength, to invest towards new ideas and products. So here we are. This brings me to the end. Once again, my name is Shaurya, and I thank each and every one of you who has taken out their precious time for this webinar. Thank you, Principal Dr. Hemlata, Vice Principal. Thank you, Dr. Charu, for organizing this, for inviting me over here. Thank you to each and every one of you who's taken out the time. I hope this has been insightful. And just before we leave, I would like you all to participate in a very small activity with me. Can you help me fill in these empty spaces? You can add in the chat over here. It's a very small activity. I'll highly appreciate if you all participate in it. Okay, so what I'll do is I will leave you all with a thought. Try reflecting during this COVID time that we have a lot of time, and I'm more than happy to take questions now.
Yeah, sir.
Yeah. Hello. Hello. Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah.
Madam. Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Before we move to question and answer sessions, I request all the participants that we have just put the link of feedback form in the chat box. Please remember, you have to give the feedback before you leave the session, and the certificates are linked to this feedback form only. Once you submit this feedback form, your certificate can be generated. And please remember, only one feedback per device is accepted on this link. Once you submit one, you cannot generate the second feedback. Okay, sir, meanwhile, we can move to the question answer sessions.
One minute, Rajesh.
I'll ask first Principal Ma'am if she wants to.
Yeah, yes, 1 minute now,
yes,
Rajesh.
Ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Hema, ma'am,
principal ma'am has left. She has another meeting at so she said that she's extremely sorry that she could not complete your session.
That's
and,
okay.
She'll be in touch with you. She wants to invite you for another webinar for management classes. And she for said, sure. Thank you very much for the session. And for from sure. my side, I express the heartfelt gratitude for joining us for the webinar. And thank it's you. Nice that I arranged this webinar for students, science students, because this field is new to them.
Absolutely.
So everything is in the right direction and the right time. The exposure is given to them, to our students. So thank you once again for joining us for the webinar.
Yes,
thank you. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity, ma'am.
Thank you, yes. Shorya.
Yes, sir. We have very basic questions from the audience. The first question is...
Absolutely.
It's a very basic question.
Yes.
How marketing differs from sales?
That's a very interesting question. So, you know, product... And the development team is other team that will put a product on the shelf, right? Marketing will help the entire organization create awareness about the product. So they are the ones, they are like influencers. So they will go out and they will talk about it, right? Sales is something which is very personal, which happens on a one-on-one level. So, you know, I might tell everyone over here that buy this product and I think there are about 188 participants over here. So just announcing it to 188 would be marketing. But if I have a personal one-on-one conversation with you and convince you to buy the product, that will be sales. So it's a very, there's a difference of a very fine line. That's why a lot of sales and marketing positions are combined. They are known as sales and marketing managers or sales and marketing executives. They have a combination of both of these job roles, but it's all about creating an awareness for marketing and convincing for sales.
Yeah. And another simple question. How to ensure that we are moving from customer-driven market to product-driven market, or how to move in this direction?
Absolutely, that's again a very good question, and that is something that you will have to define during your idea or the plan phase. So, if your product you know, as I also showed above in the four quadrants, that where you actually are placed will also help you define in which market you are. Are you in the product market or are you in the customer market? If your product is actually solving a need that is currently not solved, so that will be a customer-driven market. But if your technology outperforms other technologies, let me give you an example. So there is Zoom, there is Teams by Microsoft, and then there's Google. Google has its own, a video call platform as well. So if your technology actually stands out, then you're in a tech-driven market. So this is basically the difference.
Yeah, and last question what I have is, what is the way to increase the lifespan of a particular product? Because you said after a certain time, the product will die or it increases in profitability. Is there any certain things or any certain ways to handle that particular product and keep it alive at a constant profiting conditions?
Absolutely. There are a couple of ways to do this. Number one is to buy off all your competitions, to buy off the products that are giving you a competition, which major of the tech giants actually do, like Google, Microsoft, Facebook. For example, Facebook bought WhatsApp, Facebook also bought Instagram. So either you buy off your competition, that's number one. Number two, your product might be offering 4 to 5 key features or key services, as they said. Identify which service is actually making you the money and focus all your company strength in developing that key feature forward. These are basically the two ways. And the third phase that rarely, rarely happens is that you get into a partnership with your competition and both of you, it's called joint venture. So basically two companies come together, identify their key products and then move it forward. So these are basically some of the three ways in which you can avoid retiring a product or you can avoid end of life.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much. There are no other questions I have received up till now. May I request one of my colleagues and best friend of Charu ma'am to give you a vote of thanks formally. Mrs. Mridula Gupta, please.
There's just, I see a small question. I would like to answer that if that's
yes,
okay.
Please. Yeah.
So the question is criteria for different innovative ideas evaluation during process of new product development. This has been asked by Stuti Chaturvedi. So that the criteria is pretty simple. Let me again share an example with you. When the website Zappo, Z-A-P-P-O, wanted to launch in the market, they wanted to validate their idea. So Zappo is basically an online store, an online e-commerce platform to sell shoes. You can check out their website as well. It's called Zappo.com. So how the founders started was they went to every store, every shoe store within their neighborhood. They clicked photos of it and they uploaded the photos on their website. If at all they would get an order, they will go buy it and they will hand deliver it to their customer. This is how they actually validated their idea, their concept, their website, and they also validated the need of the customer in the market. And now Zappo is a really big platform. It's also been acquired by Amazon for billions of dollars. So this is some of the ways that you can actually evaluate during your product development phase.
Yes. Now, may I request Mridula ma'am to please formally give a vote of thanks on behalf of the department.
Very good afternoon. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes, a very good afternoon to everyone attending this webinar. I, on behalf of the chemistry department, KC College, take this opportunity to propose vote of thanks to those who have directly and indirectly contributed to this webinar. At the outset, I thank our speaker of the day, Mr. Shaurya Chaturvedi. Thank you, sir, for taking time out of your busy schedule and enlightening us with your knowledge and expertise. I'm sure all the participants have gained a lot from your insights and the knowledge garnered will help them in future. More so, looking forward to more such sessions with you. I would like to express profound gratitude to our principal, Dr. Hemlata Bagla, for her continuous support and motivation. Thank you, ma'am, for your encouragement that always helps us to conduct events like this. A big thank you to the vice principals, Dr. Shalini Sena and Mr. Justin for showing support by attending this webinar. I extend my sincere thanks to Dr. Sheila Valecha, in charge head of chemistry department, for her enormous cooperation and guidance in the organization of this webinar. I would also like to extend our gratitude to Ms. Pratiksha Kadam, assistant professor from statistics department, for her tremendous cooperation in the managing the entries, creating links, and most of the technical work for the successful organization of this webinar. I am happy to express vote of thanks to all my colleagues. Events like this requires a lot of planning. We have been fortunate enough to be backed by a team of a very motivated and dedicated colleagues
who know their job and are super coordinated. I cannot thank enough everyone. For the involvement. A special thanks to Dr. Charu Chaturvedi for taking the initiative to plan this event right from the beginning to its successful culmination. A big thanks to Mr. Mohnish Jeswani and Mr. Roshan Khelani for the logistic support behind this Zoom webinar. Last but not the least, I would like to thank all the people who participated overwhelmingly and made this event success. Thank you, everyone. Over to you, Dr. Rajesh Samant.
Yeah, before